Welcome to the Geek Homeworld. I am your host, Savage Tech Man. We talk sci-fi, TV, movies, superheroes, and all from a geek perspective. You can find us on Blogger, Google Plus, Twitter, Facebook. We're everywhere. Join the Geek Homeworld. Welcome to another exciting episode of the Geek Homeworld podcast. I'm your host, Ed, aka Savage Tech Man. And joining us once again on the podcast is Scott Schreiber. Hey, welcome back.
Thank you, sir. Excited to be here talking about one of the best movies of the year.
Definitely. I came out of the theater saying it's in my top 10 of the decade.
Oh, wow, yeah.
For me.
Absolutely.
And that's saying something because the original I didn't like as much. And, of course, we're talking about My Little Pony.
Yes. For those that are listening, we are devoting an entire hour to My Little Pony.
Oh, what? An hour?
We're not?
No, we're not.
We're doing Blade Runner.
Let's just do Blade Runner, yeah.
Blade Runner 2049. Okay, we'll do that.
A quick 30-minute episode here. And we're talking about a phenomenal movie, a gorgeous piece of filmmaking.
It is a stunning piece of art. When you see the previews that say that, captivating, stunning, it is all those
riveting
things.
I absolutely love that word. Yeah, it was very riveting. Yeah.
It had rivets
and they were beautiful. But I have one question before we dig in deep to this one. What the heck is wrong with you people out there? Why did you not support this spectacular movie?
And you're talking about the box office?
Yeah, it's by some standards bombed. And I can't I understand. We were talking earlier about some of the reasons.
Right. I think you've got, for one, it's a sequel to a movie from 30 years ago. And so if you haven't seen the movie, you may be like, well, I can't see this. And I mean, I get that, but go out and see the original.
Plus the running time.
Yeah. 2 hours and like 40 something minutes. 5 minutes. Yeah. It's long. It didn't feel like it.
That's exactly what I was going to say. There's movies I've sat in that were hour and a half, and I'm like, wow, this is too long. They could have cut out the middle part, you know, and just got to the good stuff here. But Blade Runner, I was totally, we did see it now in all fairness in IMAX. It wasn't in 3D.
No, but I think from what we've read from Roger Deakins and the director, like it's best seen in 2D.
He said, 2D and IMAX if you can absolutely see it. It really does it justice. This film was made for that IMAX format, and I was so blown away by it. Now, the original, you let me borrow the DVD, and I watched the original. I hadn't seen it in probably decades, Blade Runner, and it was good, but I found myself doing chores around the house while I was watching it.
And to be fair, it was pacing. This was the director's cut. This was the final vision that Ridley Scott had, and it does have the problems that a studio would come and say, hey, wait, it's slow. We don't understand what's going on here. And that's why there were all those issues back with the original. Like Ridley Scott and the producers really had a battle over the final vision.
Exactly. And the thing about it is I know the pacing's that way, and the pacing was similar in
2049. The original is set in 2019. This is 30 years
later.
Future. Yeah.
So saying that about 2049, I loved the vision of the future. Apparently, and we're doing, by the way, spoilers on this because you should have seen it. And
by now,
if
hopefully
you're listening to this, this episode is meant to inspire you to go see it, again. I want to see it again. But who knew in Los Angeles in 2049 there would be so much rain?
You're right, yeah.
It rains
evidently
all the time.
The
it's
drought
like
is over.
Yeah. Now, there are parts with the drought, you know, like on when they go to Tatooine.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm mixing up movies here. But if this movie does not win, like, a Best Cinematography Oscar, I'm going to cry foul.
Right.
I really am.
You've got Roger Deakins is the cinematographer on this, and he really is a legend in the industry. Real quickly, I want to go over his roster of films here. Started in the 70s doing smaller things, then did some independent stuff, and then picked up. He The first notable one is Sid and Nancy's story of the Sex Pistols, which, we won't get into that too much. But then let's just go quickly through here. He has Long Walk Home, Air America. Barton Fink was his first collaboration with the Coen Brothers. And then you're going to see at least six or seven Coen Brothers on this list. You got Thunderheart, Passion Fish, Secret Garden, Shawshank Redemption.
A little movie that no one's heard of.
No, and, yeah. Only largely considered one of the greatest films of all time. Hudsucker Proxy, another Coen Brothers. Dead Man Walking, Fargo, Courage Under Fire, Kundun, The Big Lebowski, The Hurricane with Denzel Washington. Oh, Brother, Where Art Thou? That's the one for me he should have won the Oscar for. Amazing cinematography on that. Then the black and white Coen Brothers film, The Man Who Wasn't There. Beautiful Mind that won Best Picture. Yes. Intolerable Cruelty, another Coen Brothers. The Village with Shyamalan.
It's hard, not to interrupt you, but it's hard to I think we touched on this before the podcast recording, that you could win Best Picture and not win Best Director. You know, it's...
Yeah, I that is an interesting thing, like thing we're seeing recently, where you'll see a movie win all the technical awards.
Right.
You know, Best Cinematography, Best Production Design, Best Director. And then when Best Picture comes around...
Best Sound.
Like, Best Sound, yeah, of course. And then when Best Picture rolls around, it doesn't win. So you've got movies like Gravity, Mad Max, last year it was La La Land. You've got all these that are winning the technical awards that seem to be...
Well, La La did eventually get it, which...
Well...
Yeah, we know. Yeah.
Kind of. And...
But I get what you're saying.
Yeah. And I think it's the Academy trying to spread the wealth, but why not, you know, if it's truly winning all these awards, then it's the best picture.
Right.
And so, but I have a feeling we're going to see the same thing with Blade Runner this year. It's going to win cinematography. It's going to win production design. It's going to win sound design. Stuff like that. But when it comes to best picture, it may not win. It may win best director. But... I just don't see the pattern. The pattern shows that
if it gets best director, it could be one of those. Let's give him the Oscar because we feel bad for him.
Well,
kind of.
I don't know if anybody's feeling bad for Denis Villeneuve because he's already an incredible filmmaker. His first four now are incredible movies: Prisoners, Sicario.
But how many times has he been nominated? Or
Denis Villeneuve.
Yeah,
the directors. I think he's only been nominated for Arrival last year.
Okay.
Was his first, but Deakins. I'll continue finish up his his list of movies here. Assassination of Jesse James by the coward Robert Ford, nominated for that.
Yeah,
No Country for Old Men. I mean, come on, The Reader, Revolutionary Road, Doubt, Serious Man, True Grit, Rango, which is interesting. He did cinematography on that, which is an animated film, but the way they shot that, like, it was really cool. In Time. Skyfall.
Love it. One of the best James Bond films in the top five. There.
Prisoners, another Villeneuve movie. Unbroken, the Angelina Jolie prisoner of war story. And then Sicario, Hail Caesar, again with the Coens, and now Blade Runner. And, like, and all these incredible films, he's been nominated 13 times.
Wow.
13. How many wins? Zero.
Zero.
So I feel like it's his year, and, you know, sometimes they give it to people when they don't deserve it. This won't be the case. He deserves it.
Yeah, if he, yeah, totally.
The movie is incredibly, like, just stunning visually, and even though it does feel slow at times, the story... Mm-hmm. Does pick up from the original and ties things in. You kind of get that answer to the replicant question, kind of. I still feel like it's ambiguous.
For a sequel to, you know, even though it doesn't need a sequel, but I could almost see it getting a sequel. There goes my phone. That's somebody calling, wanting me to direct. Poor podcast etiquette, buddy. Yeah, it is. It's one of our avid fans calling.
That's
I'm sure.
Right. I'm trying to chime in.
I'm just gonna let that go to voicemail. If you don't leave your name, I'm not gonna answer. But what I mean, Blade Runner, Ryan Gosling, his performance. Harrison Ford's performance. Let's talk about that a little bit.
I think they're very subtle. They're not overdoing it. Very subtle.
Right.
Harrison, you know, picks up. He's definitely a grizzled version of Deckard. And then you've got Gosling, who's really become his generation's finest actor. I mean, there's some others in contention, of course, but I mean, you think of his work and like, wow, like he's already basically, you know, this icon, you know, and now he's in this sci-fi cult classic and will become more of an icon.
Yeah. I loved his performance. I think it was a little brooding, sure, but it felt like it really fit in very well with the tone of the film. And I like, we kind of talked about this, and apparently it's construction day where I live. I'm hearing, you know, everything going by there. But I feel that Gosling and Harrison Ford, they kept with the pace of the film. They, you know, they didn't rush anything. Right. And I feel that the director's vision for them, for us to see, to experience this world, and not that this was, yes, it was heavy on the visuals, but the visuals were spectacular. And it didn't take away from the story. Those visuals added to the story. And I love that atmosphere that was created. The sound, oh my gosh, the sound on this. I mean, the screen, I think, rattled a couple times in IMAX. I saw it shake a little bit, and we were in the far back of the IMAX theater, and it just did extremely well on the sound. Was just, it was all-encompassing. I just really felt like I was in this universe, and I was not like, gosh, I wish this would hurry up. Except the fact that I had to go to the bathroom. I was like, I'm holding this because this, I've got to, I don't want to miss a frame of this movie.
You can't miss a frame of it. And I think that when, you know, all this talk of how stunning it is visually, and, you know, it's a masterpiece of art, and, you know, let's not forget about these acting performances. Like, of course, Gosling and Ford are great, but then you've got Ana de Armas, who plays his girlfriend experience, basically, the you know, the computer generated girlfriend. She's fantastic.
I'm not commenting on that because I'm married, but I love that technology, that idea.
Oh, it's really, and it, because there's this, it's really intricate to the story because it's about so being
alienated.
Right. It's about being human and dealing with or it's about whether you are human or not. Right. Exactly, right?
Is the big question.
And then, you know, how do you deal with loneliness when you, you know, when you are in this world and you're
replicants,
you don't have emotions, or you're not supposed to have emotions.
And he was a replicant.
Yes.
Ryan Gosling.
So it's like, so he's going through that, like, why do I not have emotions? Can I not be, you know, in a relationship? And, can I not be loved?
And you,
I
mean, yeah, and when he thought he was the son of, you know, Harrison Ford's character there, and kind of find out that he wasn't, right? Is that correct? Or was,
that's the way that I interpret it. Like, there is some ambiguity here. I think that because that was a main theme of the original, that Denis Villeneuve wanted to keep that level of ambiguity and say, well, that was kind of what the first one is. It made you go out and ask yourself questions. Is Deckard a replicant or not? But Ridley didn't want you to really know. He wanted the audience to figure it out for themselves and question it. And it's the same here with Deckard. I think it answers and definitively says that he's human, but that's how I interpret it. Like, I'm sure there are other people out there that say, no, he's a replicant. But for me, what I got from this story is that Deckard, Harrison Ford's character, is human. You know, you may disagree with me.
Well, I told you going in, I thought that he would be a replicant. Yeah. And coming out, I think he's human. I'm with you on that.
Yeah.
And that didn't ruin it for me. It didn't make things worse or anything like that, because I was so enthralled with the script. And Harrison Ford can act his ass off. He's a great actor, and even at his age, he's kicking ass.
And it raises the game of everybody else. You have, who else is in? Robin Wright's great.
Yes.
She was fantastic in it. You got Drax in the beginning.
Yeah, I was like, oh my God, that actor, he's so familiar. Oh, it's Drax.
It's Dave Bautista from Guardians of the Galaxy. And he's only got a short scene, but he's really good in it.
You see it. And just the grittiness of this whole world. It's very Mad Max-like in a sense, but it's
its desolation. And, you know, yes. the worlds are completely different in look. Mm-hmm. But as far as just like, you know, desolate, isolated, you know, yeah, I agree with you on that.
Right. We are just, or at least I am, I was just overcome by the movie. I left out of there just saying, wow, I really feel that the $8,000 I spent on this ticket, even though it was a matinee, was money well spent. And I want to actively encourage people to go out there and support this movie. This movie can still have some legs on it. And it hasn't opened, as of the recording of this, in China or Japan.
So though the money will come through those markets for sure.
Massively, I think.
And, you know, I think the more people see how this, you know, more people read reviews of this, they may go out, get the original, and watch it, and then go out and see it. That's really what I think's holding it back.
I wonder, though, I mean, you have to look at it, and you see, that's the thing about looking back at something, and then you compare it to this bright, new, shiny, well, you know, even though it's gritty, 2049, then you have the original Blade Runner, and it's very techy for its time. It's like 80s tech imagined, you know.
Right, there's a lot of paying homage to the original.
Right.
Now, Ridley Scott did produce this, so there was that. You know, and I think the screenwriter was actually the same screenwriter.
So
there is that continuity that comes over.
But it's easy to look and say, oh gosh, that's so not good visually, the original Blade Runner, comparing it to our standards today and what we're used to. But you need to keep an open mind, especially if you've never seen the original Blade Runner. It's going to run slow. It's not going to be your typical box office explosions here and there.
You're not watching a Michael Bay film.
Right. Yeah. Oh, thank God. Thank God he did not do this movie. Ridley Scott, this is one of your masterpieces. Blade Runner, 2049.
And I think they did a great job of, I feel like if you go back, there are probably a lot of shot for shot, like they were like, hey, let's do this scene exactly like this from the original. And there's a lot of paying that homage. Even the end scene where Kay is fighting the female replicant there at the end, the final, you know, the climatic scene, that I think they're doing that in the water. It's an ode to that final scene with Rutger Hauer on the rooftop.
Right. I'd forgotten how much of a big artist he was back in the early 80s for like action, those kind of sci-fi tech movies. I mean, Rutger Hauer was a badass.
It would have been awesome for them to figure out a way for him to be in this, but I get why it's not. But God, it would have been cool.
And it was so interesting. Jared Leto did a great job in this, and I cannot remember his character's name.
But he basically takes over the company that's genetically making the replicant. So and he fills in that role very well. He was even like, it seemed like he was blinded, and you know how the guy that ran the company in the original like gets his eyes gouged out, and I think
maybe that's an homage to
and there's little things like that.
I almost think they could have cured blindness in the future had they not had the fallout. And
well, hold on, maybe that's what those little things were. Maybe he is blind, and those little four things that are flying
that's
around,
exactly what I thought those were.
Okay.
Those are like his eyes.
I had a hard
eyes.
Time. Like, I was like, okay, so what is the significance of this? And it was just think he was blind, and that was...
I totally think that's what those were. You know, and they can actually see in better spectrums, probably, I imagine. And they didn't go into this, but I imagine there could be a way that someone could tap into that video feed and see it, you know, if there was someone else, you know, a shadow kind of person behind him, you know, in his organization, which is something that I don't want them to rush out and make a sequel to this.
I don't know if you'll ever see another one.
Yeah, you said that
really
valid point.
Think so.
And if we don't ever get another one, I'm happy.
Sure.
But
absolutely.
I'm eager now to see what the technology is finally kind of caught up where you can do with computers. You can do anything visually pretty much that you can think of. And if they apply that to, you know, they obviously applied it to 2049. If they can apply it to a future Blade Runner, that would be interesting. But yeah. I feel like the story has, you know, it left it wide open when he goes there and sees his daughter and he, Harrison Ford, he's got his hand to the glass.
Go back to a question you asked earlier when you said, did you think that Gosling's character was actually his son? And I don't know. Like, you could still argue that, but I think we're supposed to take the statement that Harrison Ford switched the records and made it look like there were two kids when there was really one. Right. So I think you're supposed to just take
that. Because one of them died correctly. Am I correct on that? Or did both of them?
No, I don't think there were ever two.
So you think,
I think he, because he said that he knew how to switch the records. And so he made it look like there were two children. But really there was only one, and it was a girl, not a boy. And so, you know, I think that there is only one child.
He implanted the memories that he has, though. I mean, those memories were really, I guess, the girl's memory.
Yes.
So that's interesting that they even switched that perspective.
That's the daughter's memory that got implanted in him. Yeah.
Yeah. And then just,
that's because they have that scene where he's sitting, where Gosling is sitting with the daughter and shows him, or he shows her his memories. And she takes aback and said, like, when she says it, she's startled and she looks at him and says, those aren't your memories. And so it's like, and then like only later do you understand.
Right. They start doing the little flashbacks.
That she's like, that those were hers. Those were her memories.
So that's an interesting level that they can do that and then plant those kind of memories. And of course, he's a machine, he's a replicant. So I suppose that's easy in the technological world of this Blade Runner universe.
Yeah. So they, you're right. They can, they have a jumping off point where they could do another one, but I don't think they came into this with that intention. I think they came into this and said, let's make this a great film. And if we never do it again, fantastic.
Do you think the studio is enough to say, okay, Kubrick, you know, we fought over your vision and you got to do your final cut of Blade Runner. We give you basically the total freedom. And they said, screw it. I don't care if it makes money. I'm sure they care that it makes money or that it hasn't made the kind of money the studio would look at and be excited about. Because if it already made a couple $100 million right now, they would already be signing a screenwriter.
They would already be doing it.
Yeah, and if Kubrick, it would be wrong because they would then also.
I love that you keep saying Kubrick because he's my favorite director
Kubrick?
Of all time. Yeah.
Why am I saying
Stanley Kubrick twice now? But that's great.
We were talking Stanley Kubrick earlier. Maybe. Oh my gosh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, no, we're talking Ridley Scott. But the
Ridley
fact
Scott,
that.
I don't know.
But the point is very similar to Kubrick in that he has a vision and he's going to do it the way he wants to do it. That's how Kubrick was, and that's how Ridley Scott was or is still. And I think that this may be the end of the Blade Runner franchise, but I would be fine with it because it's a fantastic film. You want to come back to it in the 30 years? I'll go see it. You want to come back to it in 5 years, I'll go see it. But it's just, I don't think it's necessary.
So, for a correction, Ridley Scott.
Yes, Ridley Scott.
Did a spectacular job producing
Believe
this
me, I wish Kubrick was alive and making these movies.
Well, I just rose him from the dead, you know. I just made that up, you know. It's like, apparently. Because we were talking Kubrick earlier, and I'm sorry. Because we're doing this off the cuff, but. We wanted the podcast about this when we got out of the movie. It just didn't work. Our schedules didn't work out and all that. And I think having some time to think it over and let the movie sink in.
Yeah, that's a good thing.
It's a great thing. You have to go see this movie. We're not being paid, obviously, to promote this movie, but I was that impressed. And for me, going in and watching the original, like I said, I was like, it's good, but it's not capturing me the way I want it to, and then I go in and I'm just blown away by 2049. So I'm satisfied, and I secretly do want a sequel, but I don't want a sequel at the expense of damaging this near-perfect movie. in my mind.
We're not going to get it anytime soon. I think the best way to do another one would be to wait at least 10 years.
And I don't see Harrison Ford's character coming back. I mean,
he is still connected to the girl. And so maybe you could,
unless they film some scenes that they'll save for later and slap in a sequel. I don't know, and no offense to Harrison Ford, but I mean, he's in his 70s. Yeah. I don't, if they wait 10 years,
I know hopefully the problem forever, with these franchises that he's been a part of. It's like they want to keep these franchises going, but they have to.
The next Indiana Jones movie, we don't want to see him pushing a walker.
They have
around,
to figure out a smart way to transition.
Yeah, and or pass the baton. And I mean, his character, I have no problem if there were a sequel to 2049, if they come out and just replay some of that footage, and maybe they, even if they have one little scene, or if he's not around at the time or whatever, can't do the movie.
He doesn't have to be a major part of it. It's like how they did with Sean Young's character. Like they just used footage from the original movie and inserted it.
But I think they did such a good job. She didn't move much, so it looked like, when they de-aged her. I don't know if that's the technical term on it, but it worked. But I noticed she didn't move. I made a point of saying, she didn't move all that much. So, for the CGI people and all that, it worked out well. So, anything else you want to mention about Blade Runner 2049?
I just, it stands out as easily one of the best of the year. Gorgeous. Yeah. Nothing is going to rival its production design. I mean, maybe Star Wars, but I just don't see it rivaling the production design on this. And I see it winning, let's say, early predictor, I'm going to say 4 or 5 Oscars, but not Best Picture.
Not Best Picture.
Even though it might deserve it. It's not the type of movie that wins.
I'm going to vote for Stanley Kubrick as a producer on this one. Not Ridley Scott. No, I'm just joking. But I think it deserves best. Well, it's hard to say best picture because there's all so the much stuff coming out.
Yeah,
now.
All the movies aren't out yet. Dunkirk was fantastic. There are movies that are going to be.
I had some issues, with Dunkirk, but it was just, I think the storytelling on it for me was the three separate parallel timelines and like there not being enough ships in the water.
For me, it's brilliant, but it was a
good movie. Yeah, and other than that, we've got a lot of great movies that we're going to be talking about. Some that aren't really even geek focused, or geek centric or whatever. But there's some brilliant movies that are coming out over this holiday season and into next year that we're both excited to see. And hopefully you will be too. But please go out and watch Blade Runner 2049. Tell all your friends. If you can see it in IMAX, that's your best bet. And, it won't be in IMAX long, I don't think. I think it's going to,
I'm trying to think.
Thor's coming out. So Thor's probably
Until November 6th or 7th, whenever Thor's coming out.
Yeah, Ragnarok's going to own that. And that's going to be an awesome movie. I just think that's going to be so much fun. Or Guardians 3, as I'm calling it, but that's okay. So we're going to wrap up here, and I want to thank Stanley Kubrick for joining us here.
No problem. Anytime. Anytime.
All right. Any final thoughts, Scott?
Just let's watch a bunch of Stanley Kubrick movies.
I could do that. We can get some 2001 Space Odysseys in here and all that. But alrighty, Ridley Scott, great job. Ryan Gosling,
Denis Villeneuve, quickly becoming one of the greatest directors out there right now.
Yep. All right. Well, thank you guys for joining us here at Geek Homeworld. Please look us up on Twitter at Geek Homeworld. Let us know what you think of the episodes and listen to some of our past stuff. We've got a lot of great content, like our fall movie preview, a little bit longer, but any movie you could possibly care about, and some you're not even sure that you should care about yet.
We touched on it.
We touched on it on that last episode, so our fall movie preview. So check it out, and along with some other stuff there. But this is Ed signing off along with Scott here.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming back, and you guys enjoy the movie. Go see Blade Runner 2049.
Go see it.
All right. Bye.
Thanks for listening to another episode of the Geek Homeworld podcast with your host, Savage Tech Man. You can find us on Libsyn, Google+, follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook, listen to us on iTunes, see us on YouTube, be part of our Mixlr chats. Thank you. See you again on the Geek Homeworld podcast.